morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Hindus Thought Conclave, The Huddle, presented by Yes Bank and powered by SRM University. On behalf of The Hindu, I'd like to extend a very warm welcome to our chief guest, Honorable Vice President of India, Sri Venkaiah Naidu. I'd also like to welcome Honorable Mahinda Rajapaksa, the Leader of Opposition, Sri Lanka. May I please invite on stage our chief guest, Honorable Vice President of India, Sri Venkaiah Naidu, Mr. N. Ravi, publisher, The Hindu Group of Newspapers, and Mr. Mukund Padmanabhan, editor, The Hindu. May I request you all now to please rise for the national anthem. We will begin this morning with the lighting of the traditional lamp. May I please request our chief guest, Honorable Vice President of India, Sri Venkaiah Naidu, Mr. N. Ravi and Mr. Mukund Padmanabhan to kindly light the traditional lamp. Thank you very much. I now request Mr. Mukund Padmanabhan to please present a bouquet to our chief guest. I request Mr. Mr. N. Ravi to present the memento to our chief guest, Honorable Vice President Sri Venkaiah Naidu. May I now request Mr. N. Ravi, publisher of the Hindu Group of Newspapers, to deliver the welcome address.
Good morning, Honorable Vice President Sri Venkaiah Naidu, Honorable Sri Rajapaksa, Sri Mukund Padmanabhan, Sri Ram, Sri Pandya Rajan, honored guests. Welcome to this very special event on the second day of the Hindu Huddle. The Hindu has had a long-standing relationship with Bengaluru and Karnataka that was strengthened with the printing of its edition in Bengaluru in March 1970, and further with a renewed focus on the city in the last 5 years. This morning's event is very special for us at the Hindu Huddle, not just because of the office that Sri Venkaiah Naidu holds, but also because of his sagacity, political experience, eclectic range of interests, and oratorical skills. his climb to the top of the party structure earlier and now to the high office of president has been gradual from the grassroots, propelled by his extraordinary talent. Starting as a volunteer of the Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh and with his training in law, he has had a wide range of experience in public service as a student leader, organizer of the JP movement, campaigner against the emergency that earned him a 7-month term in prison, member of the Andhra Pradesh Legislative Assembly, member of the Rajya Sabha, minister, and finally vice president. With an affable nature, he has friends across the political divide and is a warm and generous host, known for his sumptuous fare in his annual parties. He often relates an amusing story of how he was sought to be dissuaded from joining the RSS with the tale that it was an organization of vegetarians that did not allow non-vegetarian food. He joined the organization on being assured that there was no such restriction and he was allowed to eat what he wished. He was elected to the Andhra Pradesh Legislative Assembly in 1978 and 1983, served as the spokesperson and president of the BJP's Andhra Pradesh unit, became National General Secretary of the party in 1993, and served as president of the BJP from 2002 to 2004. He served in the cabinet of Atal Bihari Vajpayee as Minister for Rural Development, introducing among other schemes the Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana. When the NDA formed the government in 2014, he served as Minister for Urban Development, and during this period, real estate regulation was brought in, and subsequently, he served as Minister for Parliamentary Affairs as well. His interests are eclectic, and a look at the website of the Vice President carries his addresses at a Gandhi Memorial event to students and at the inauguration of the Apollo Proton Cancer Hospital, besides messages on the occasion of Republic Day, the New Year, Christmas, Deepavali, Guru Nanak Jayanti, Miladun Nabi, among others. His oratorical skills in Telugu, English, and Hindi are well known. He is a master of the turn of phrase and effective use of alliteration and similes. His most visible role now is as chairman of the Rajya Sabha, where with political tempers rising with the approach of the general election, keeping order is a major challenge. His affability, friendship across party lines, and experience as a 4-term member of the Rajya Sabha should help in meeting this major challenge of keeping order in the Rajya Sabha. I now have great pleasure in inviting the Honorable Vice President to deliver a special address.
Sri N. Ravi, publisher, Hindu Group of Newspapers. Sri Mukunda Padmanabhan, editor, Hindu newspaper. Sri Mahendra Rajapakshe, leader of the opposition of our friendly neighbor, Sri Lanka. Sri Pandirajan, Sri N. Ram, and other members of the Hindu family, brothers and sisters. I feel extremely happy to be here this morning. Of course, I have a little tight schedule, and I always enjoy tight schedules. I have 3 more programs, reach Delhi to attend the last program. I always feel it's a pleasure to join Hindu debate or even going through the newspaper Hindu because of its standard way of reporting news. I used to remember, I think I have said it earlier, during my student days, we used to have one reporter by name Mr. Chundi Viswanatham in my town, Nellur. And people used to say, if there's somebody unfortunately is expired, the Hindu reporter visits his house, examines the pulse of the individual, comes to the conclusion that is no more, then the news is sent and news is published. That's how people used to describe Hindu in my younger days. So when Mukund Padmanabhan told me that there's a program like this, of course, which I have attended earlier, I have readily accepted to come over here, and I really feel happy to be part of this huddle. Huddle to remove hurdles in the way of the nation, in the way of the world community. Hurdles that are coming in the way of the development of the humanity. Our opportunities and challenges is the subject I want to just focus today. This is a historic year for us as it marks the 150th birth anniversary of the father of the nation, Mahatma Gandhi. It is also the time for us to reiterate our unwavering commitment to the constitutional principles and introspect if we are practicing the ideals and values of Mahatma and other great icons like Jawaharlal Nehru, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, Subhash Chandra Bose, and many more, who had made huge sacrifice to free India from oppressive colonial regime. As we fast forward to the present times, we need to seriously ponder whether the progress made by the country over the last 7 decades was to its potential, or could we have done better? This is the introspection that is needed. Recent statements from the international organization like World Bank, International Monetary Fund, Asian Development Bank, makes it abundantly clear that today India is the fastest growing large economy and poised to become the third leading major economy in the world in the next 10 to 15 years. Opportunities are beckoning us, and we need to seize the moment. These are challenges that are there impeding our progress. I feel all the political parties, irrespective of who is in power, should agree on a common agenda when it comes to vital issues relating to the nation's progress, security. For that to happen, every politician should raise above narrow, short-term rhetoric. While economic reforms have been backed by majority of the parties, I would like to appeal to all political parties to adopt policies of consensus on promoting inclusive growth. I underline inclusive growth, ending agrarian distress and making agriculture profitable, eradicating poverty and illiteracy. Even after 71 years of independence, still 18 to 20% of the people are living under below poverty line. Around 20% of the people cannot write and read. And then you have some account of urban-rural divide. And you also hear here and there some sort of gender discrimination or social discrimination, etc., that you see in the newspapers. And also, we come across certain instances also. So these are the really challenges. The fighting the menace of corruption, which has become a worldwide phenomenon, which has been. And the bridging the urban-rural divide and protecting the unity and integrity of the country. Unless these challenges are tackled on a war footing in a mission mode, the fruits of development will not reach every deserving section. Wiping every tear from every eye, as Mahatma Gandhi has said, should be our sole mission. We should not be happy that only because of the fact that we made so much progress, we have now smart cities, we have national highway program, we have bullet train coming, we have new airports coming, we have full swing public-private partnership model. So many things are happening, no doubt about it, positively. At the same time, we must also introspect whether the growth is inclusive, whether we are able to make everybody to feel that is part of the developmental story, even if it is 5%, 10%, 15%, or 20%, whatever it is. That is the challenge before us. Then only you can call country as a developed country. I would also like to reiterate that diversity of opinion is necessary for a vibrant and healthy democracy. At the same time, nobody has the right to create anarchy or chaotic conditions in complete disregard to the law of the land. Dissent is acceptable, but not disintegration. Often there is a debate sometimes. There is no scope for dissent. There is a scope for dissent. If not India, where else it is? You go through the newspapers. You can read articles. You can read the speeches of different leaders from different political parties. What not? They say everything. And also, the system is functioning in such a way to absorb this criticism. But at the same time, you cannot compromise on the basic issue of the nation's unity and integrity. Regarding economy, I am happy that our microeconomic fundamentals continue to remain strong, with India emerging as an attractive investment destination. Worldwide economy is going a little slow. People say 3% or so. Even our neighbor, which is a powerful economy, is going a little negative, 6.8 or so, China. So India is the ray of hope, is the favorite destination for the investors. I have been Minister for Urban Development for some time before quitting politics and joining this august office of Vice President of India. I had the experience of various ambassadors, ministers, prime ministers coming to India, evincing interest to invest in India. And they find there are greater opportunities. They're happy that ease of approvals, ease of doing business. All these things are initiated, and also they are happy about the pace of reforms. Everybody is being talked about, because they're all very much impressed about the reform, perform and transform, the three-line mantra that has been given by the Prime Minister, practiced by the country. And I am happy to share with all of you that there is no party worth the name which is opposed to reforms. Interpretation may be different. They may take different stands, while in power, while in opposition. But broadly, when it comes to the question of reforms, no party is opposing reforms. That's a happy trend. One way, it's a positive trend. That our macroeconomic fundamentals continue to be strong, as I told you, the IMF and other global agencies have indicated a growth rate of 7.3 this fiscal and 7.5 around next following years. Even as the global economy is slowing down, India has emerged as a bright spot, and this is the time for us to further consolidate our position on the global stage and ensure the living standards of our people, particularly of the poor and downtrodden, improve further. For a developing nation like India, the need of the hour is to sustain momentum of economic growth and dovetail its efforts for increasing prosperity, well-being, happiness of the people. Simple prosperity alone will not suffice. There are so many things required to make people happy. Making agriculture viable, improving farm income, because 54% of the people still continue in agriculture. Agriculture is the basic culture of this country. So we have to give priority to that. Improving farm income, bridging the urban-rural divide, eradicating poverty, tackling climate change, which is also posing a serious challenge, harnessing technology, empowering women, and creating jobs are essential to sustain growth momentum. Economic development has to be translated into human and social development. No doubt, we are living in an independent world, interdependent world, but we need to insulate our economy from the vagaries of global ups and downs. With the government declaring its intention to increase manufacturing share to 25% of the GDP by 2025, the prime focus should be exponentially increase our domestic manufacturing. That should be the focus. We have a demographic advantage, as 65% of the Indian population is below 35 years. No other country has this advantage. The need of the hour is to effectively implement as well as supplement the government's skill development program by imparting skills on a massive scale to the Indian youth. The private sector must also play a big role in exercise of funding skill initiatives as part of the CSR activities. India has no other alternative but develop highly skilled and semi-skilled human resource to be globally competitive. We are fortunate, this land, this water, this air, and this country, there is an additional added advantage. India was known as Vishwaguru once upon a time. Students from abroad used to come to Takshashila, Naranda, Pushpagiri, so many other places to have education. Even our now Indian youngsters and Indian people are excelling in various international forums. You have a chief economist of the IMF, Indian, the two from this state. You have the heads of different Indira Nui, Sundara Pichai, Nadella Satya. You have so many stories, Sagurthi Purna of the American Inch Bank. So many cases like that. That all shows there is skill, there is knowledge. What is required is giving an opportunity and upgrading the skills. The taddy tapper, the weaver, the fisherman, goldsmith, blacksmith. All these sections of the people, they have some inherent skills. What is required is identifying those skills and then upgrading those skills. I'm happy that the government has started a skill development department separately, and the Prime Minister has elected a minister for the same. The private sector also, what I want to stress is, they should also focus more on skill development. They also need skilled people. I'm glad to note that there's a healthy competition among the states to attract investments and accelerate the process of industrialization. State after state, I have been to a number of states, including this state, Tamil Nadu the other day, and earlier Andhra Pradesh, different states ruled by different parties. They're all holding investors meet. They're all trying to remove the obstacles. Earlier, people used to talk of a red tape. Now, the popular, this thing is a red carpet. Every state is competing with each other for the investment, for the betterment of the state, for the development of the state. That's a healthy trend. My dear sisters and brothers, India is on the right trajectory, but it's imperative now to maintain the momentum. That is what is important. Only a consistently high growth rate will ensure prosperity of the people. India has immense potential to be in the forefront of the fourth industrial revolution and transform the country into an innovation hub. We have to completely reorient our school and higher education system in tune with the fast-changing global scenario and equip our youngsters with the needed wherewithal to come out with the futuristic inventions and innovations. While enabling holistic development of the students with emphasis on excellence and creativity, our education system must also enhance awareness on the importance of preserving culture, tradition, and heritage. We have a culture, thousands of years of civilization. Our forefathers have lived and they have passed on to us. We have to preserve it, promote it, protect it, practice it in such a positive manner. And then, you know, in the basic philosophy of India is share and care. Share and care is the core of Indian philosophy. That should be taught to our children right from the beginning. Earlier, joint families together, they also live together. So grandmother, grandparents, they used to teach the students. And now, this also is weakening, not a good sign for the country. And there's no time also now for the children also. They have such a heavy syllabus. And then TV, internet. So they don't have time to spend time with the grandmother and grandfather. This is an unfortunate situation. Internet of Things, data analytics, 3D printing, robotics, artificial intelligence, cloud computing have become the buzzwords. Thanks to digital technology, the world we are living in changing at an unprecedented pace and scale. Today we have smartphones, smart cars, smart cities. We have innovation, we have incubation, we have startup, we have stand-up, so many programs. Earlier during my student days, stand-up means when you go to class late, then teacher used to ask you to stand up. Now the stand-up and startups are different. The policies of government are reoriented. That encouragement is given to startups, which is a very positive trend. And some of the private companies are also encouraging startups. That also is a positive trend. It should be continued. It is obvious that we cannot adopt a business as usual approach if we want to be the pace setter in the fourth industrial revolution. Even if automation and machines take over some of the tasks, the requirement of the people with skills will continue to remain high. A global consulting firm has estimated that India will have a talent surplus of 245.3 million workers by 2030. While there will be a global shortage of 85.2 million skilled workers. Therefore, the need of the hour is to impart digital, technological, and leadership skills to today's youth and equip them to take on future challenges. The Indian Skills Report of 2018 states, I quote, with the changing nature of work and workplaces, the desired skill sets of most occupations are likely to comprise ones that are not yet considered crucial for the job today. Various initiatives launched by the government like Skill India, Startup India, Digital India, Make in India are all aimed at creating an ecosystem for India to not only meet the domestic requirement but also global demand. I feel higher education institutions and industries must take lead in reorienting the skill sets of the country's youth. Growing disposable incomes, bourgeoising middle class and rapid urbanization are offering opportunities and throwing up new challenges as well. Urbanization has become a reality. Even if you don't like it also, you can't reverse it. Education, employment, entertainment, enhancement of economic opportunities, enhanced medical facilities, they're all focused in urban areas. That's why we have to think about focusing on the rural areas also to create these basic requirements for the people so that the migration can be controlled, if not fully stopped. This has to be understood. That's a trend. Even I am from a village. Earlier I was rural development minister and then I migrated to urban development ministry. During Vajpayee's period, I was rural development minister. It was my choice. When Rangaraja Kumaramangalam expired, the Prime Minister invited me to join the government. I was looking after party. So when I joined the government, he was suggesting some portfolios, economic portfolios. So I told him, sir, this is not my favorite subjects. I'm not an expert on energy, on surface transport, etc. So then he said, what do you want? I said, either agriculture or rural development. He laughed at me. Rural development? I said, rural development. So I have taken rural development, try to do something. But later, this Prime Minister came, then we have been given urban development. Then I asked my other friends, "Bhai, what is the reason for assigning urban development to me, that is son of a farmer?" They said, now that so much migration is there to urban areas, Prime Minister wanted you to take care of the rural people who are coming to urban areas. That may be one of the reasons at all. But it's a reality. So we have to accept this challenge and follow what late Abdul Kalam ji has said, Pura. All these facilities which are there in urban areas should also be focused in the rural areas. 71 long years after independence, the country is saddled with several challenges. As I said earlier, 18 to 20% of the population still living below poverty line. And topmost endeavor of our every government has to be improve their living standards. Similarly, the other challenge, including making agriculture profitable, people are leaving agriculture. How to stop it? How to make agriculture viable and profitable, sustainable? The Prime Minister said 2022, we must double the income of the farmers. How do you do it? In what manner? These sort of solutions that are appearing here and there, of loan waiver, this giving this free, that free and all. Free power. Free power means no solution at all. Free power means first low power, then no power. No power is free power only. So we should not be carried away by this trend. And even the loan waivers also are temporary solution. They are not permanent in nature. Because every season, as an agriculturist I know, every season you need credit. Every season. Not every year, every season. Rabi, Kharif, all. So we have to find solutions to and also go for structural changes. And this should be done by centre, by the state, and also other agencies, universities, Krishi Vijnana Kendras, and all together. That is what is required. I have been trying to impress upon the government. The Prime Minister also had discussions on this, even after becoming Vice President. I have been holding consultations across the country with people, great people like M.S. Swaminathan, Ashok Lahati, so many other people, Sharad Pawar, former minister. We had a number of huddles like that in Chennai, in Pune, in other places also to exchange of ideas and all. Some better ideas have come and are being passed on to government. My dear friends, the sustainable income, that should be our approach. Achieving 100% literacy levels, ending gender discrimination by changing conservative mindsets, bridging urban-rural divide by developing rural areas on par with urban regions, and eliminating caste barriers to promote. It's really a shame. Here and there, even in certain areas, even now, people try to discriminate and that becomes a big news naturally. So we have to focus and change the mindset of the people. These things cannot be done by mere legislation. Legislation is not the solution for all the problems. You have to change the mindset of the people. You have to educate the people. The education institutions, the political leadership, the media, and all sections, they have got a greater responsibility in educating people with regard to gender discrimination, with regard to social discrimination. Even they are here and there, they are happening. I remember in Parliament there was a discussion around, we have a weakness. Whenever something happens, people say, bring a new legislation. When that Nirbhaya unfortunate episode happened, many people were clamoring for a new bill. I said, there are enough bills. What is required is not a new bill. Though I am not opposed to that, what is required is not a new bill, political will, administrative skill, and go for the kill of the social evil. I said, that's it. These are the social evils. So we have to accept there are even certain places, even if they are nominal, but they are all challenges. Inclusive economic growth should be central to our development. I stress on that. Making people living in rural areas as integral part of the developmental process should be the aim and of the policy makers and planners. Promoting investments in modernizing agriculture, mainstreaming of rural livelihoods, and creating market avenues for rural population will help in ensuring equitable development. I would also like to point that one of the biggest areas of concern, rather challenge, is the all-round deterioration of values and morals among different sections. This, unless we arrest this growing decline in ethics and standards in all walks of life, the country will face problems in future. It is very important. We also need to constantly remind ourselves that the framers of the Constitution has clearly demarcated the powers and functions of the executive, legislature, and judiciary. Nowadays, you see a tendency that the one wing want to get into the other wing and perform that responsibility, forgetting their own responsibility. This is an area of concern. I don't want to elaborate on that. People concerned, they all understand about whom I am talking about this. The delicate balance between the three wings should be maintained at all times, and nobody should encroach into the domain of others. The wheels of democracy will run smoothly as long as each wing functions within the democratic domain, allocated domain, and not overstep into others' jurisdiction. This is also equally important. Setting the house in order, perhaps should start with Parliament and legislatures. I am truly concerned about the decay in the functioning of the Parliament and legislature. What is happening in various legislative forums in different states? I need not elaborate on that. And secondly, what is happening even in Parliament also? And disruption, obstruction. I always say very simple, there is a solution to this. Let the government propose. Let the opposition, if it wants, oppose. Let the government propose, opposition oppose, and let the house dispose. That is the way forward. There is no other way. Going to the well is not going to solve the problems. I remember somewhere, Rajagopalacharya said, one of the great intellectuals of this country, he said, if you are not well on the facts, go to the well of the house. I don't know whether that is happening or there must be some other reason and all. Competitive obstruction is no good for democracy. Because MLAs, MPs, they are all seen as idols for others to follow. So we have to set high standards. Time has come for all political parties to evolve a code of conduct for their MPs and MLAs and ensure that Parliament and legislature function effectively to fulfill the aspirations of the people in the large democracy. India is one of the oldest and largest parliamentary democracy in the world. We all feel proud of the same. But at the same time, we are supposed to maintain those standards and then convey to the world community how effective is parliamentary democracy. For that, the people in parliament and people in political life, they must all introspect. That's why I found it's not because of individual, it's because of parties. And I talk to MPs, "Why, what are you doing?" When I call them to my chamber, they say, "Sir, what can we do, sir? High command se humko. Aaj house chalega nahi." First, without coming to the house, they tell me, house is not going to function today. Party. That's why I'm suggesting that political party should prescribe code of conduct for their MLAs, for MPs, and see to it that they follow scrupulously. That will really further strengthen democracy. I also feel that all political parties should not resort to populist, impractical and short-term promises to win elections, as the country's economy would suffer in long-term due to unproductive schemes. We need to empower people to stand on their feet rather than making them increasingly dependent on government. After 71 years, we are supposed to have become mature. This temporary lollipops, populism is not going to help the country at all. It's not going to end the poverty. All populism, I need not explain in detail what is populism. There is a competitive populism happening in different states of the country. The parties which make tall and impractical promises will have to justify and explain to the people how they would finance to fund such schemes. This is a big question. They should, and they are making an announcement, they should talk about fiscal responsibility management, FRBM limits. They should also say, this is the debt and this is the expenditure. How am I going to finance this? If one is able to explain it, that will be really good. That will make them more accountable. And I feel that this is an important issue and the country should have a wider debate on the points, some of the points I have raised. The other major challenge the country needs to address on a war footing is the deficiencies in infrastructure development. The government is already addressing the issue by building roads, highways, networks, development of ports, promoting regional and air connectivity. However, I feel public-private partnership also should be encouraged further to scale up for accelerating the pace of infrastructure development. We need to promote massive infrastructure projects in the country to compete with each other and also with other countries also. My dear sisters and brothers, while the economy is poised for unprecedented growth, there are two important dimensions that we should not lose sight of. One is equity. And the second is ethics. In the wake of economic offences by some individuals, I would urge upon business bodies like FICCI, ASSOCHAM, CAA and others to evolve a code of conduct for their members, as business and ethics must go hand in hand for sustainable and steady growth. I also implore industry bodies to weed out black sheep who bring a bad name to the business community because of the actions of few people. The image of the country is getting third. I also feel that the time has come for various nations to arrive at a consensus not providing shelter to economic fugitives. It should be remembered that economic offences pose a direct challenge to nations' health and wealth. There are two challenges before the world community. One is terror. Terror has no religion, has no region. The entire world must come together. I don't know how long the United Nations is going to discuss this issue. It's inconclusive for years together. And then they must isolate the people who are aiding, abetting, funding, training terrorists. Second is corruption. Corruption also has to be eradicated. Then only really the fruits of development reach the ordinary people. So these two challenges, the world also should seriously think about it and then come out with their own solutions and cooperate with each other. You loot here, cheat here, and then go and stay in some other country. And then all countries must have voluntary extradition treaties to exchange people, to exchange information about such offenders. This is also need of the hour. Finally, as I told you, I'll be failing in my duty if I do not express my views on the media scenario in the country. In the past, journalism was a mission. Politics was a mission. Medicine was a mission. Of late, some people are trying to make it a commission and giving some omission and doing some remission. That should not be the mission of the country. We should rectify these situations at all levels, all of us. We have a joint responsibility. Political parties, people in high offices, and as I told you, the business people and also the media people. Every one of us, we're all stakeholders in the future and growth of this country. We have all got a solemn responsibility on this. Today, we find that some of the news stories are slanted to suit the views of management. How many newspapers are coming? Earlier, it was a mission, as I was talking about Hindu mission, and so many other, Ramnath Goenka, it was a mission. Even we have so many examples, C.R. Irani, mission. Lot of people were there. But slowly, what is happening? Certain people with business interest, commercial interest, they are now starting newspapers. They are starting channels. And how many channels, nobody knows. Earlier people used to say, sir, there used to be only one channel. Dora Darshan, Doorse Darshan Karna, black and white Dekhna. Now we have more than 1,000 channels. Making news, breaking news, good news, bad news, khud unka news, ek dusre ke khilaf news bhi chal rahe. If you watch clearly some of the channels, there will be running stories against each other also to further their own business interest or settle their scores. And then this another weakness is that news and views should never be mixed. News is news undiluted. News should reach the people. Views should be confined to editorial page. News and views should never be compromised. That means you are doing injustice to the people. And the news which you publish, that information you want to give to the people must have confirmation. Information with confirmation is more than nomination. If you have confirmation of the information which you are giving to people, that can be used as more than a nomination. Sometimes the media does it, different media. And that's really brought changes. We have all seen it also after positive effects of the same. So nothing to worry about that. There is no question of imposing any restriction and all. But at the same time, you have a responsibility to pass on the unpolluted, undiluted news to the people and leave the views, judgment to the people. While giving your own side of the views, you can say, this is my view. That should be the approach. The media outlets are being started for commercial and political considerations also. Nowadays, we are in South, people start channels. Some political parties also started channels. Some individuals also started channels. Within one party, four people also, because there are four groups. These are all realities. Let us, when we are meeting here and then exchanging ideas, these are the realities. How to check these trends? By system or by the people? All of us should really ponder over this. We must provide pure and unadulterated news to the people. Mindless sensationalism. There is another weakness. Sensationalism. Sensationalism means without sense. For TRP. Or for some other thing. And then paid news. That's a very disturbing trend. If you go through elections and then find out and talk to the candidates that some of the newspapers, they make such a this arrangement that this much coverage, column wise. This is a very disturbing trend. It may be even limited, but it should be curbed in the beginning itself. That's why I suggest that the media association should also come out with a code of conduct for journalists to ensure professional integrity. Before concluding, I call upon every section of the society to strengthen the foundations of democracy with a positive mindset rather than promoting negativism. We are no more under foreign rule. We are on our own. You are electing state government. You are electing central government. You are electing your own representatives. So while electing and selecting people, four C's should be remembered. One is character, caliber, capacity, and conduct. But unfortunately, some political forces are trying to replace those four C's by another four C's. Character, caliber, capacity, and conduct. What are the other four C's the others are trying to force in? The other four C's are caste, community, cash, and then criminality. They are very, you can all see. I need not name anybody or any party. Brazen manner, people are encouraging and then trying to get advantage. Sometimes they're getting away with this also. So we have to really educate the people, and this such discussions, debates, we always be able to get different views, and then what are the good practices in different parts of the globe, different parts of the country, different parts of within state, we'll be able to understand. Because there is a saying that wise men learn from others' experience and fools learn from their own experience. We are all wise men, we all join together and we try to exchange information. Conversations for a change, this 2 days conclave, is a very well-intentioned, better time. Good practice that is being followed by Hindu newspaper, and let us wait for the thought-provoking ideas for building a new, inclusive and forward-looking India. I would like to thank the Hindu management, its editor, for providing me this opportunity to come over here and to participate in this Huddle event at Bengaluru today. Namaskar, Jai Hind.
Thank you, Honorable Vice President of India, Sri Venkaiah Naidu, for your very insightful special address. I now request Mr. Mukund Padmanabhan to deliver the vote of thanks.
Okay, so here's my thanksgiving, Vice President. This is your second visit to the Huddle, sir. You came first as minister, and we're very happy that you were able to come again as chief guest for this our third edition of the Hindu Huddle. Clearly, high office hasn't dampened or altered your disarming informality and your sense of humor. But this touch of lightness that you've brought to your speech has not undermined the significance of what you've said in what was a very, very wide-ranging address that touched on a number of issues that impact on our social, cultural, and political life. There are many takeaways, but I will flag what I thought was the central part of your address, which was to flag a notion of development that is more inclusive and that's not pegged wholly on just infrastructure of growth. Also that you highlighted and you underlined that if we are to maintain our economic momentum, then we do need to do a lot more to combat poverty, to improve the lot of our women and improve our skill sets. And all around, we just need a more holistic development that focuses on sharing and caring, as you said at one part. Also, thank you. I think this is absolutely true. We are all stakeholders in this effort to improve our economic and social fabric. That doesn't exclude, it's not for politicians alone. It involves, as you said, businessmen, academics, and journalists as well. Thank you for flagging that. Thank you very, very much for coming, and thank you.
May I please request all of you to stand up for the national anthem?